A very good evening to everyone. I am Pooja Phatte. Organized by the Agricos Alumni Association with the Botanical Society of Goa. First of all, I welcome our webinar's coordinator, Sir Miguel Braganza, who is Organic Agriculture Consultant and Mentor. Miss Priyanka Naik, Miss Estella Pires, and Miss Shivangi Paidarkar. Before we begin with our session, I would like to request everyone to please turn off their mic and camera. You can write in the chat box. Session. Miss Priyanka Naik, she is agriculture graduate from DBCA Sulkarna. She is the owner of Priyanka Farm from Priyanka Gardening Service, a joint manager of Rasraj Farm Goa at Mollem. She has been a guest lecturer for different occasions. Apart from that, she has also been a teacher of grade 1 teaching horticulture to pre-university student. Soon after graduation, she already presented two research papers at International Conference of Sire Science. She has anchored a TV series on urban gardening for CCR TV channel. She is elected as treasurer for Botanical Society of Goa, veteran for organizing Plant Utsav and conducting all Goa home gardening competition. She has demonstrated many agriculture related demonstration all over Goa in 40 schools. So I welcome Priyanka. You can proceed with your presentation.
Thank you, Pooja. Good evening, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about trap crops. So what is the importance of trap crops and how they can be beneficial for us when we are looking at insect pest disease control? So next slide. So what are trap crops? So basically, trap crops are the crops which are planted along with the main crops. Suppose we are going to have a huge plantation of any particular crop like chili or cabbage or any cauliflower or cucurbits, and we want to control those pests but without using any chemical-based fertilizers, or we don't want to use any kind of measure wherein our food is affected with the chemicals. The major fruit which we are going to harvest from the field, it should not be affected by any kind of chemicals or alkaloids. We are going to use something called as trap crops. Now, these trap crops are the normal plants or vegetables which will, if we grow them singly, we could harvest the yield from the trap crops also. So these are the plants which are basically planted along with the main cash crop, which will give us the yield and the harvest. And this is planted accordingly to give the protection to the main crop from the pest which will otherwise feed or breed themselves and survive on the cash crops. So basically, this trap crops helps us to get rid of insect pest attack in a larger way. So when we have a cash crop along with a trap crop, this helps us to reduce the use of any chemical-based fertilizers or any kind of chemical which are to be sprayed to get rid of this insect attack. Next. Next slide. Okay. Now, how to visualize a trap crop? For a better understanding, trap is a word we usually we use like something that has to be captured, right? So here in this image, you can make out like this is a rat trap. Usually when we have a rat infestation in a house, we keep a rat trap. For that rat trap, we keep something, some kind of food material or food item that attracts the rat, and that's how we trap the rat into that machine, right? The same way here in agriculture, what we do is we have something called as trap crops. So here this trap crops will attract the pest which will infest onto the main field or the main crop which you are going to harvest. So here, along with the main crop which you want to harvest as a cash crop, we'll plant trap crops. Now these trap crops will be the host for this pest. Like these trap crops will be planted before the main crop, just before 20 to 15 days before the main crop is planted into the main field, so that the insect population which is already present in the in your field or vicinity gets attracted to that trap crops, and all those insect pests gets multiplied or start feeding onto the trap crops itself when your main main crop which you are supposed to plant into the field is going to give you a crop. Are going to give you a harvest. So what will happen is all the insects are already getting attracted to the trap crop, which is for this trap crops you are not looking at the economical point of view. So this helps us to get rid of these insects prior they are going to affect the main crop. So you can spray your organic based alkaloids, or you can take the mechanical controls or cultural controls when they're already infesting on the trap crop. So by the time your main crop comes into picture, or they are starting rooting into the field, they are not going to get infected by this pest which are otherwise infecting your harvest. Will get control if you have a trap crop into the field, because they will start collecting the entire pest population onto those plants which are not been planted for the harvest. So that's the example, like how what is the concept of trap crop. Next, so on what major principles does a trap cropping work on? Now we'll be looking we'll be wondering that why the insects go onto the trap crop and not onto the main crop. Okay, now this basically the trap crops which are going to plant are insect specific. That is, every trap crop will differ according to the crop you want to grow. For example, if you are going to grow the cruciferous crops like broccoli, cabbage, radish, or cauliflower, this type of crops, all the cruciferous family, they have a particular host plant, they have a particular insect that will go and infest onto this crop. So to get rid of those pests which are specific to cruciferous family, we'll have a trap crop which is going to be similar to the same plant, same mother, main plant. So the trap crop will be for the cruciferous family will be like radish, which is quite similar to the cruciferous family, and also marigold. Okay, now marigold has an alkaloid which attracts the insects because of its fragrance. The carotenoid alkaloid which is present into the marigold plant attracts all the insect pests which is going to attack the cabbage or broccoli, and because of the alkaloid present into it, the insect get confused, or their central nervous systems get into a confused state, and they get attracted to this fragrant flower that is the marigold, because this alkaloid gets a particular fragrance. That fragrance attracts all the insect onto it, and that's how the population which the insect which are going to damage the main crop are going to go and attack the trap crop, and they are not going to infest the main crop. So that's how the trap crop will have all the pests which will have gone and seated on field and start feeding onto the main crop will come and sit onto this trap crop, and they'll start damaging it. So the main damage it will have caused to our main crop, that is a cauliflower, will be reduced, and also we can spray the organic pesticides or the other insecticides onto the trap crop and avoid spraying anything onto our main crop. So we have totally organic food, which is free of any kind of alkaloids. And also when you have a trap crop, it makes a big difference into our field because you do not have any kind of larva or any infestation of these insects, the pest, insect pest, multiplying into the field, because we can control them on the trap crop. And this trap crop has certain trap crops like marigold, they have alkaloid, like they can kill the soil borne pests like nematodes and all. So you can control them organically. Next slide. Okay, so major techniques of trap cropping. Here, the selection of preferred cultivar or a species is important, because if you are going to grow something like cotton or vegetables, okay, or suppose if you are going for a tomato cultivation and you are going to plant radish as a trap crop, then it is not going to help you to a greater extent. Because in case of tomato, if you want to control the diamondback moth, then you can go for marigold as your trap crop, or you can have sunflower as a trap crop so that it can collect those insects which are otherwise going to affect the tomatoes. So if you want to have a tomato cultivation and you want to plant something as a trap crop which will also look beautiful in your field, then you can go for sunflower, which will start pulling all the insects which will go and affect the tomato plant. So what you have to do is, if you are going for a trap cropping in case of tomato cultivation, you can plant the sunflower seedlings at least 20 to 30 days prior, 20 days prior of tomato seedling transplantation, so that once you have your tomatoes onto the main field, they are not being infected by this insect in a great way. So you can minimize the risk of damage if you go for a trap crop of sunflower. Or even tulsi is also a good trap crop in case of vegetable cultivation, and even marigold can be planted. And another important factor that we are looking at when you are going for a trap cropping is, you have to make sure that the cultivar which you are going to plant, the main crop, has to be of the and the trap crop which you are going to plant for the main crop to save your main crop from the pest damage, has to be from the same species. That is, if you are going for a cruciferous crop, like for example broccoli or cabbage and all, the trap crop has to be from their family itself. Like the trap crop has to be something that is attracting most of the insect and can kill them at a initial stage itself. Like in case of cruciferous, we can use radish, or in case of vegetables, you can use marigold, or in case of sweet corn, if you want to grow, then you can grow cotton as a trap crop. So these are the some points that we need to keep in mind when you are going to select a trap crop for your main field. Next slide. Now there are two methods of trap cropping, like how you want to lay out your main field. So here is an example. If you have a field and you're going for a cucurbits like watermelon or cucumber into your main as your main crop, then you're going to grow a trap crop at the border. So this is called as perimeter trap cropping, when you're growing all the trap crops in the border and your main crop will be in the center. So whenever we have a trap crop, it has to be planted earlier than the main crop. So you have all the squash plants which will be acting as a trap crop for the watermelon, cucumber, and other cucurbits, like if you are going for a ridge gourd and all. So all those bottle gourds and all, if you are going to grow into the main field, then you have a squash which is going to trap all the insects which will go and infest these cucurbits. So we can control them at the initial stage when they start affecting onto the trap crop, and your infestation on the main crop will be reduced to around 66%, or even 50% of the population will be controlled, and hence we will be getting harvest much more better than the otherwise conditions. That is, if you don't have a trap crop. Next. So next method you can use is if you are going for a row plantation, that is region furrow type of plantation, or if you have a plantation of the strawberry or plantation of turmeric, then you can have this trap crop in between the row. That is, within the row itself, you can have your trap crop grown. If you have two plants of strawberry, then in between that, you can have marigold grown, or in between the two crops, two rows of the plant, you can have one strip of marigold. So that is a row within the row trap cropping. Next. Next is strip cropping. So here you can see in this picture, in this strip cropping, you can have two main crops in the field, and in between the two main crops, you can have one trap crop. So that is strip trap cropping, wherein the two main crops will be safeguarded under one trap crop itself. So here, the trap crop for cotton and peanut is sorghum, wherein all the insects which are going to infest the cotton and peanuts will be diverted to sorghum, and your main target crop will be saved from the pest infestation. In case of sorghum, here the main target insect they have targeted is green stink bugs, which will have infested cotton and peanuts. Next. Another technique or another method that we need to consider when you're going for a trap cropping is we need to maintain some border as a grassy corridors. That is, we should have some vegetation around our field so that the beneficial insects like lady bird beetle or the lace wing bug should be present in our field, so that whenever we have a pest infestation into our main crop, then these beneficial insects are multiplying into our vicinity itself. So we can use something called a selective insecticides, wherein these beneficial insecticides, insects will not be killed by those harmful chemicals, and we are going to multiply them into our vicinity of the main field, and those can be used to get used as an agent to target onto the insect pest crop. So this helps us to increase the population of the beneficial insects when we have a vegetation around the main field, which helps us in breeding the beneficial insects, and also we'll have a natural enemy which is conserving into the vicinity. So this helps us when we have a diversity of pests which is attacking into the field, and we also have a beneficial insects which are breeding into the field. So that's how we can make a competition and get rid of the pest naturally. Next. So here are some of the examples which I have listed for you all to have a general idea, like which crop goes along with the trap crop. So if you have a main crop as your garlic or ginger, then you can use your tulsi or a marigold as a trap crop. You can have them in your border. The method of planting of the trap crop can be around the border of the main crop, and this will help you to control the thrips. The pest which is controlled under this condition will be thrips. Then if you have vegetables or ornamentals, then you can have the trap crop as chervil or a coriander will also act as a best pest to control your slug population. Then if you have cabbage or cruciferous as your main crop, then you can use radish as your trap crop. You can use them along the strip or at the border of the main field to control the nematode to control the cabbage, webworm, flea hopper, and mustard aphid. If you have a main crop as cruciferous, like or a chili solanaceous crop, like your chilies, tomatoes, brinjals, cruciferous like cabbage, then cauliflower, legumes like cowpeas, then you can use marigold as your prep crop. You can grow them in between the rows, or you can have them in a strip plantation, that is one row of marigold, and alternately you can go for another another row of solanaceous crop. You can have one row of entire tomato cultivation and one row of marigold cultivation, so that the pest population gets diverted to the marigold strip and you don't have any pest which is infested onto the main crop. So the pest which is controlled under marigold as a trap crop is nematodes. Then if you have a cotton or a okra as a main crop, then you can use cotton as a trap crop. And if you have a cotton as a main crop, then you can use okra as a trap crop. So this will help you to control the weevil, that is the okra weevil, and also the weevil which attacks the cotton. Then in case we have a cotton as a main carrot as a main crop, then we can use onion and garlic in border form or in between the crop as a trap crop to control the carrot root thrips. And in case of cruciferous, we can use radish to control flea beetles and root maggot. Even cabbage acts as a trap crop in case of tomato to control the diamond back worm. So these are the examples if you want to use a trap cropping to control the insect pest population in our main field. Next. Now, how to control them? Once we have the insects which have been feeding and surviving onto the trap crop, how to control them is we can go for organic solutions like neem oil. You can use neem oil onto the trap crops frequently. If you don't want to use onto your main crop, then you can use this neem oil onto the trap crop and control the pest population at the initial stage itself before they are going to multiply into the field and infest the main harvest. And you can even use yellow sticky traps to attract all those pests. And we can also use other organic solutions like Viverra baziana, which will go. So if you don't want to use this organic chemicals onto the organic alkaloids onto the field, and you want to use which is going to give you the harvest of the fruit, then you can use them on the trap crop and control the insect population, because they'll be more in number than on the main crop. So if you want to control them on the trap crop itself, you can use these chemicals more frequently and control the population onto the trap crop itself. Next. So Viverra baziana, here this beneficial fungus which feeds on the insect body, you can go with the spray of Viverra baziana wherein your hoppers, flies and beetles which will have been infesting your main crop can be controlled onto the trap crop by frequently spraying at 10 day to 15 day intervals, and you won't have any of these fungus going to attack your major fruit when they are going to flower. Because if you are going to spray this fungus during the flowering stage of the main fruit, then it will also infect the honeybees, and that is more dangerous because we want honeybees for a pollination purpose. So we can use this fungus onto the trap crops and get rid of the insect pest. Then to control the soil-borne diseases, we can use this Trichoderma viridae as a stick treatment or for soil wrenching to avoid soil-borne fungal diseases, and Pseudomonas fluorescens for the foliar and upper ground diseases to control all the fungal diseases. So these are the two methods you can use for fungal diseases. So when you're in case of Pseudomonas fluorescens, you can go for 10 gram per kg of FIM. You can multiply the beneficial this fungus of Pseudomonas into the FIM and then incorporate the FIM into the soil so that this fungus spreads into the soil, so that all the fungal spores which are present in the soil gets killed into the soil itself. And you can also go for seedling root dip, that is you have to dilute the 10 gram into 1 liter of water and go for and dip your seedlings into the solution of Pseudomonas fluorescens and then go for transplanting. That helps to get rid of any fungal spores which are present onto the roots of the plant, and that will avoid any risk of fungal infection to the seedling. In case of Trichoderma, this also helps us to get rid of all the soil-borne pathogens, fungal diseases which will be occurring from soil. So you can go for a seed treatment. Once before sowing, you can go for a seed treatment. You have to put your seedlings, seeds with the Trichoderma powder. And if to go for a, you can even go for a soil drenching. That is 10 gram can be dissolved in 1 liter of water, and can go for a soil drenching. That is, you have to use the solution as a spray into the soil, wherein all the pathogens in the soil will be killed by this Trichoderma viridia fungus, and your field will be free of any diseases. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Priyanka. So, our second speaker, Ms. Stella Pires, she is a recent agriculture graduate from Don Bosco College of Agriculture. Her determination of getting self-employed in food sector made her choose agriculture as a profession. She is currently runs a startup called Casa de Vegetis, wherein she grows seasonal organic veggies and microgreens at home and market it. Today, she'll be talking about different composting methods which can be done in farms. A very warm welcome, Stella, and over to you.
Thank you, Gayatri. My topic for today is insect repellent plants. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yes. Thank you. The first plant is Tulsi, that is also called as holy basil. So this plant can be planted as an intercrop or even planted on the boundaries or corners of the garden. And each household may be having this plant, which is very much useful. It has medicinal uses as well as insect repelling properties. So uses of this plant in insect repelling, that is, it repels mosquitoes, whiteflies, and bugs. So the leaves of Tulsi, they have a very strong smell, which helps to repel the mosquitoes, the whiteflies, and the bugs. Next slide, please. Next is lemongrass. So lemongrass is planted on the boundaries of the garden or in the fields. So this lemongrass, they have very strong natural oils which help in repelling bugs. So the leaves of this lemongrass, they have a very strong smell, same like the tulsi. So this help in repelling the bugs from the garden. And they have also an anti-inflammatory medicinal property. Next slide, please. Garlic. The most common ingredient in every household, I can say. And this plant can be intercropped with beans to repel the aphids. Now, in the coming season, most of us will be might have already started preparing and planning to grow beans in the next season. So you'll need to intercrop it with garlic so that this aphids, which is a most common pest in beans, gets avoided or repelled. So this also repel, along with aphids, garlic also repels mites and mosquitoes too. So you'll need to do is cut small pieces of garlic and spread it in the room, or else crush some garlic, boil it with water, and make a spray solution, and you can spray it around. And also the garlic peels are burnt with dhoop, and with the smoke which is created, it repels the mosquitoes, and it also deters slugs. Next slide, please. Lemon balm. So this plant almost looks similar to mint. It belongs to the family of mint, but it is a kind of a mint. And this plant is usually intercropped with okra. So this have a very strong smell, which repels bugs and mosquitoes and fungal ants. Next slide, please. Citronella. So citronella and lemongrass, they almost look similar, but citronella will have this reddish color on the stem, whereas the lemongrass will have a shade of white to yellow color stem. So this is usually planted on borders or in the corners of the gardens or in the fields. And and this is also planted as an intercrop. So this has a insect repelling property, and it also helps in repelling worms, thrips, aphids, and some squash bugs, then mosquito bean beetles, because of this strong smell. So like lemongrass, even citronella has somewhat similar smell. Only thing you can distinguish between them is with this distinct red color on their stem. Next slide, please. Catnip. So this is one plant which is loved by cats also. And this plant can be intercropped with gourds, melons, pumpkins, and cucumbers. So this plant around mango, it is also planted around mango tree trenches and in mango orchards to get rid of fruit flies, which is like the most common pest in mango. And it also has a insect repelling properties. So this can be a great non-toxic substitute for synthetic sprays. Instead of synthetic sprays, we can use catnip. Next slide, please. Nirgundi. So Nirgundi, which is also known as five-leaf cash tree in English. And this plant is usually grown in fruit orchards. Orchards to get as an intercrop, and traditionally this was the leaves of this plant were used to get rid of wool destroying insects and worms. So these leaves were placed in the woolen garments, and the woolen were stored in the woolen garments to get rid of insects and worms, and the leaf powder is used to repel bed bugs. So this tribe called as Lodha tribe in Odisha and West Bengal, they use this method to repel bed bugs. So dried leaves, they are burnt in fire to keep the mosquitoes away. And even in the fields, the dried leaves are spread in the fields and then they are burnt in order to keep the harmful insect pest away from the field. Next slide, please. Lentana camara. So this plant, you might have seen it almost everywhere with different colors of flowers. And so this plant is usually planted in the corners of the garden or on the boundaries. And its leaves, they have mosquito repelling property. So the leaves are dried and then they are burnt to repel mosquitoes. Next slide, please. Neem. This plant is very common to us, and I guess most of the household will have at least one plant in their garden. So this plant can be planted in the garden itself and also as an intercrop in orchards. So this plant has a good insect repelling property, which repels bugs, caterpillars, mites, cockroaches, and mosquitoes and bed bugs too. And the dried leaves are used to get rid of store grain pests. So mostly in the rice and all, the dried leaves of neems are mixed with rice and they are stored in order to get rid of the store grain pest. And this plant, it also acts as a wind barrier. So most of the time, there are these neem cakes which are available, which are very effective pesticides. That is, neem is used in organic farming as a biopesticide. There is neem silt oil, which is available in the market, which many use to get rid of insects from their garden. The neem is a very beneficial crop, I can say. Also, it has many medicinal properties also. The roots, leaves have good biopesticidal effects. Next slide, please. Eucalyptus. So this plant is grown as an intercrop in plantations, and it helps in very good wind. It is grown as a windbreak crop. So on the boundaries in fields of corns and vegetables, so that the crops, they don't get destroyed by heavy winds. So these eucalyptus trees are grown as wind barriers. So this eucalyptus, they have a very good bug repellent properties, and they are also used to get rid of some parasites like ringworms and some tropical parasites. And they have also ticks and mites repelling properties. So even in your pets, if there are any ticks and mites problem, eucalyptus can be a great help. Next slide, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Stella. We have our final speaker, Ms. Shivangi Sudesh Paidarkar. She is from Prior Madur, Goa. She is BSc Agriculture graduate from Konkan Krishi Vidyapeeth, Dapoli, Ratnagiri, Maharashtra. She had done her MSc in Horticulture, Vegetable Science at University of Horticulture Sciences, Bangalkot, Karnataka. She is currently working as Assistant Agriculture Officer at Dharbandoda. She will be talking on the topic marigold cultivation. A very warm welcome to you, Shivangi, and over to you.
Yes, thank you, Gayatri. Am I audible to you? Gayatri, you can tell.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, thank you. Yes, as each and every one of us know that Goa is a state with immense cultural heritage and land of beauty, and it is also known for the agriculture. As I said, Goa is a land of cultural heritage. Flowers like marigold are in great demand during festivals. But the bitter truth is, we are dependent on the neighboring states for the marigold flowers. So here I am, Ms. Shivangi Paidarkar, Assistant Agriculture Officer at ZO Dharbandoda. I would like to focus on a cut flowers with immense value, easy growing and high income crop, that is marigold. So coming to the importance of marigold. Marigold is one of the most commonly grown flower crop for garden decorations, and it is also seen in front yard gardens of Goan households. It is used for making garlands. Yes. Okay, fine.
Okay, now.
Now it is visible.
Yes, go ahead now.
Okay. So, marigolds are ideal for landscaping and also as a bedding plant. Then, Essential oils are also extracted from the marigold. Marigold contain a pigment called as xanthophyll, which intensifies the yellow color of egg yolk and broiler skin. Also, a natural dye is extracted from the marigold flowers, which is used in foodstuffs and in textile industry. Then, as one of my fellow met who also focused on trap crops, marigold serves a great trap crop for repelling insects. So, marigold is known as Jendu in Marathi and Roza in Konkani. It is an important cut flower belonging to the family Asteraceae. It is originated in Central and South America. It is a national flower of America and it is widely cultivated in China, India, and Peru. And in India, Madhya Pradesh is the highest producing state. There are nearly 50 species of marigold known to mankind, but African marigold and French marigold are commercially grown. Coming to the difference between African marigold and French marigold, African marigold grows 50 to 100 centimeter tall, whereas French marigolds are bushy and grows up till 30 centimeter tall. Even the flower size is large in case of African marigold and it is small in case of French marigold. Both have globular head. And in case of African marigold, color varies from lemon yellow to golden yellow or orange. And in case of French marigold, color varies from yellow to mahogany red, as you can see in the picture. There are many cultivars or varieties of the marigold developed by public as well as private sector. In case of African marigold, there are varieties like Pusa Narangi Genda, Pusa Basanti Genda, then Sirekal, Gold Spot 1-2, Ashtagandha, Kolkata are developed by the private sectors, which are widely used. Then also Nivalaska, Spun Gold. And in case of French marigold, there are so many varieties like Butterball, Flash, Color Magic, Rusty Red, Susanna, Valencia, etc. Coming to the climate and soil requirement of the marigold crop. It is very easy to grow plant and can be grown in wide range of climatic conditions. Mild climate is better for luxuriant growth and flowering. Temperature ranging between 18 to 20 degrees Celsius is good for the growth. And when the temperature goes above 35 degrees Celsius, it restricts the growth of the plant. Then coming to the soil, marigold can be grown in wide range of soil and different types of soils. French marigolds, that are dwarf marigolds, prefer light soil, whereas African or tall marigold require moist soil. Then soil with pH between 5.6 to 6.5 is ideal, means preferably sandy loam soil are good for the cultivation of the marigold plant. So coming to the propagation of the marigold. Commercially, propagation of the marigold is done by using seeds. Seeds are black in color as shown in the picture. They are viable for 1 to 2 years and seed of the marigold germinates within 2 to 3 days once we sow. Then seed rate is 500 to 600 gram per hectare. And another method of propagation is by terminal stem cutting. As you can see in the picture, 5 to 10 centimeter long stem cutting is taken and it is planted in July to September. Then seeds are directly sown in the field or are transplanted. Again, for transplanted crop, nursery can be raised in field itself in a raised on a raised bed or by sowing in a pot trays. And sowing in a pot tray is more advantageous over the first one, that is in field itself. So if we are sowing in a pot tray, then potting mixture, we should take coco peat and vermicompost in 2:1 ratio. Cocopit helps for maintaining the moisture level, whereas vermicompost helps to meet the nutritional requirement. And trichoderma, 2 gram per kg, we should mix in that potting mixture. Trichoderma helps to suppress the growth of the plant pathogenic microorganisms. This nursery or pro tray becomes ready for transplanting at 4 leaf stage, means after 4 to 6 weeks. Then again, you can spray Jivamrut or Panchagavya or Vermi Wash, which will add additional benefit. Also, it will meet the nutritional requirement of the crop. Once the plant becomes ready for transplanting, we should take care of following points. That marigold seedling is very easy to grow, I have already said. It is easy for transplanting also, and it gets established in the field very easily without much mortality. As I said, it should have 3 to 5 true leaves. Then thin and long seedlings do not make a good plant. When there is no proper sunlight, then plants become lanky. That plant is not suitable for the transplanting. Also, very old seedlings should not be transplanted. Again, after transplanting, the land which where we will transplant the seedling should be well prepared. And after transplanting, soil is pressed around the root zone and light irrigation is to be given. Coming to the spacing, proper spacing should be there during transplantation. 45 by 60 centimeter or 60 to 60 by centimeter spacing should be there. Between the plants and between the rows. Then also this marigold can be grown as a border crop with the main crop, or it also acts as a trap crop, means as you can see in the below picture, that one or two lines of marigold with the main crop. Here main crop is chili, and in between they have grown marigold, so it serves as an additional income. So if you see the number of seedlings, how many number of seedlings can be occupied in 1000 square meter, that is 1250 seedlings are occupied in 1000 square meter area if we take a spacing of 45 by 60. Then what is the season or sowing time of marigold? It can be grown year round. But in rainy season, if you are going, then July end to first fortnight of August. So if you sow in July or by the end or first fortnight of August, then this marigold becomes ready for selling, or you get the produce in exactly during the Dashera or Diwali time when it fetches a good market. Then in winter, mid-September to mid-October, and if we are taking a summer crop, then first week of January to first week of February. Then coming to manures and fertilizer, during land preparation, 24 tons of FYM or cow dung manure per hectare should be added, and to meet the nutritional requirement, soil application of 2 kg of Azospirillum and Phosphobacteria per hectare at the time of planting should be done. Also, these biofertilizers are to be used after mixing with 100 kg of FYM during application. Then irrigation is done once a week or as and when necessary. Water stagnation, yeah, this is the main point. Water stagnation should be avoided. If there is plenty of water available, then irrigate the crop in 7 to 8 days interval. In rainy season, there is no need of irrigation, or according to the climatic condition, you can go for the irrigation. And only thing we should see, that there is constant moisture supply we are maintaining from bud formation to harvesting of the flowers. Then there are 2 main intercultural operations which need to be done in marigold cultivation. And since if we see Goan conditions, we grow tall varieties, so it needs stacking. Stacking means giving support to the plant to control lodging, and pinching, which improves the branching of the plant, thereby giving more yield. So pinching is removing or trimming the terminal growing shoot to encourage the branching. As marigold is very hardy crop, it does not bear much diseases and pest. Only thing in nursery stage, damping of sometimes it is observed. So proper drainage and ventilation is must, and avoid overwatering. Pseudomonas fluorescens 15 ml per liter helps for fungal helps to prevent the fungal infestation, and also Trichoderma species 2 gram per kg into a growing medium also helps for preventing plants from a fungal disease. And drenching the Trichoderma 10 gram per liter of water after transplanting will also helps to prevent or protect the plant from the fungal diseases. Then pest of marigold. Again, as I said, for the disease, there are no much pest incidents observed. Only thing, a few mealybugs or thrips or red spider mite can be observed. Spray of neem oil, 5 to 10 ml per liter of water by adding any kind of shampoo will help for controlling mealybug. Then use of yellow sticky traps, 20 per acre. Spray of neem oil, 5 to 10 ml per liter of water. Spray of Beveria bassiana, 10 ml per liter of water will be useful. Then coming to the harvesting. Marigold crop becomes ready for harvesting after 40 to 50 days after transplanting. Loose flowers are harvested depending on the full size, depending upon the variety. Flowers should be harvested in the morning hours. Irrigation before plucking gives better flower quality. And again, you should go for removal of dried flowers regularly to enhance the yield. And for garland stock, less fully opened flowers are picked. And from one plant, nearly we get 100 to 150 flowers. Again, it depends on the climatic conditions, variety which you are using. And the blooming duration of the marigold is nearly 2 to 3 months. Coming to the yield, average yield is 15 to 28 ton per hectare from 500 square meter area. If 625 plants are planted, and if you are getting from one plant 3 kg of marigold, then 625 into 3, 1875 kg you can get flowers from the 500 square meter area. And if you are selling it in rupees 100, then there will be the profit of 1,87,500, and accordingly for 1,000 square meter area, it's calculated. So what is the assistance under agriculture department? There is 75% assistance for cultivation of marigold under National Horticulture Mission and State Sector Scheme Development of Horticulture. You will get 75,000 per hectare. But criteria here is Krishi card is mandatory, and minimum area is 500 square meter. And this assistance is given for individuals as well as self-help groups. These are some of the success stories of Dharbandura zone where I am working. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Subhangi. You can speakers or type it in the chat box.
I think you can conclude.
I would like to thank our session coordinator, Sir Miguel Treganza, and our Agricos Alumni Association for conducting this webinar. I thank all the speakers for taking efforts and giving us informative session. I also thanks all our participants for attending the webinar. Thank you, everyone.